Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha and today's topic is part 2 of molecular aspects of host-microbial interaction. In the part 1 of this topic, we discussed all the molecules that participate in the host-microbial interaction, and today we will discuss how they interact, that is the pathway, followed by a brief discussion on the role of complement system and antimicrobial peptides in these host-microbial interactions, followed by the important aspect, that is therapeutic strategies based on this knowledge. So starting with the pathway that the TLR and NLR recruit, as per the diagram, as per the pathway from the textbook Carranza, here the interaction that is described is mainly between TLR4 and lipopolysaccharide, which belongs to the cell wall of gram-negative bacteria, that is example Porphyromonas gingivalis. Now how they interact, that is the first step to be discussed. Please watch it very carefully. The structure of TLR has an N-terminal and C-terminal. This N-terminal is the site for interaction with lipopolysaccharide. This TLR4 contains N-terminal and myeloid differentiation factor 2 and accessory proteins CD14 and lipopolysaccharide binding protein LBP. What this LBP does, LBP, as the name suggests, it will bind the lipopolysaccharide and deliver it to CD14. This CD14 will then sensitize the cell membrane. So this cell will be sensitized to LPS after binding with the TLR4-MD2 complex. Now, the thing is clear, lipopolysaccharide binds with TLR4 via this mechanism. Upon binding, that is upon the interaction, there will be direct recognition. This leads to the domain at the C terminal called TIR domain, toll interleukin 1 receptor signaling domain. The name signaling domain, that means now it will recruit a pathway. The most common adaptor protein pathway recruited by all the TLRs with the exception of TLR3 and endolysosomally located TLR4. Remember, all the TLRs will recruit MYD88 pathway. The exception to this are TLR3 and the endolysosomally located TLR4. Remember, TLR4 is unique because it can locate on both plasma membrane and on endolysosome. Here we have shown the TLR4 that is located on the plasma membrane, but TLR4 can also locate on endolysosome. So the TLR3 and TLR4 which locates on endolysosome will recruit alternative pathway, that is TRIF and TRAM. We will discuss that as well. But the main pathway, the most commonly recruited by all TLR4, are MYD88, that is myeloid differentiation primary response protein 88, and its adapter like protein molecule, that is MAL. Clear? Now upon this recruitment of adapter proteins, that is MYD88, via this TIR domain located at C terminal of TLR4, this recruitment of MYD88 will now interact with the molecules, namely interleukin 1 receptor associated kinase and tumor necrosis factor receptor associated factor. These interactions will further activate the transforming growth factor beta activated kinase 1, TAK1, which leads to the interaction with nuclear factor kappa beta and the MAPK-P38, that is mitogen activated protein kinase. Now these molecules will enter the nucleus, reach their location on the target genes, transcription, and hence the production of the cytokines, mainly pro-inflammatory cytokines, that is interleukin 1 beta, interleukin 6 and tumor necrosis factor alpha. Interleukins and tumor necrosis factor, mainly by the MAP-PRR interaction. Here the example is lipopolysaccharide and TLR4. Similar pathways have recruited by TLR9 and TLR2 for those located on plasma membrane, but for those located on the endolysosome, which are involved in the identification of nucleic acids, they will lead to the interactions and production of interferons. This is the difference. The endolysosomally located TLRs leads to the production of interferons via recruitment of the alternative pathway, that is TRIF and TRAM. And that leads to the activation of the interferon receptor factors 3 or 7, according to the TLR that is interacting and leads to the production of interferons. So this is the pathway that is recruited by TLRs. The next pathway, the role of NLRs, that is NOD-like receptors, nucleotide binding oligomerization domain. Remember, the important word is oligomerization. So let's say NOD1 or NOD2, again they interact with broad range of MAPs, be it exogenous or endogenous. So let's say most commonly they interact with peptidoglycans. So now when peptidoglycans binds with NOD1 and NOD2, leads to the oligomerization. That is why the name NOD, nucleotide binding oligomerization. This oligomerization will now lead to recruitment and activation of this molecule RIP2. And hence, the same pathway continues as by TLRs. This is probably the crosstalks between all the TLRs and the NOD-like receptors, which is responsible for the synergistic or the supraphysiologic outcome, that is response for inflammation in response to the MAPs. So this is how NOD-like receptor, that is NLR, work and TLR work. So this completes the pathway by NLR and TLR. That is the host microbial interactions at the molecular level, the pathways, how the production of cytokines or interferons takes place. Clear? In these interactions, not just this pathway, in that entire picture of host microbial interaction, there are two more things that participate apart from these molecules, that is complement system and antimicrobial peptides. We will briefly discuss their role, assuming we know the basics of it. So about complement system, if you have gone through my video on keystone pathogen hypothesis, we have already discussed the applied aspects of the role of complement system. How essential is the complement system in maintaining the periodontal tissue integrity? Because complement system mainly involved in maintaining the periodontal tissue integrity by all the pathways of complement system, mainly classical lectin alternative pathway. In a nutshell, the complement system pathway, that is the classical lectin and alternative pathway, all these three pathways converges or meet at C3 factor. Then the C3 convertase will carry forward the pathway, that is it cleaves C3 factor into C3A and C3B. C3A is an anaphytotoxin, that is it recruits the neutrophils. Whereas C3B is a phagocytic enhancer, that is it is involved in opsonization and hence phagocytosis. Clear? Then it further cleaves C5 into C5A and C5B. Again, C5A is a cell receptor activator, that is anaphytotoxin. Again, recruitment of neutrophils. And C5B will carry forward the remainder of the pathway, that is terminal pathway, that is it recruits or binds with C6, 7, 8 and 9, ultimately forms a complex, MAC, membrane attack complex, which leads to the lysis of the target pathogen. So this is the complement system pathway. Now the role of complement system in periodontal diseases, as we have already discussed in keystone pathogen hypothesis, if there is any derangement in the complement system, that is according to the keystone pathogen hypothesis, the keystone pathogen mechanism, that is complement subversion or corruption of complement system, it leads to periodontal diseases. This highlights the role of complement system in periodontal health integrity. Clear? So this is about complement system. The next component are antimicrobial peptides. Now antimicrobial peptides are numerous in number that are found in oral cavity, more than 45. But to our concern in periodontal diseases, defensins and LL37 cathelicidin are mostly studied. A brief introduction of these antimicrobial peptides, that is defensins, are of two types, alpha and beta, based on their structural distinctions. And cathelicidin, LL37, is the sole cathelicidin. Now, how they protect us, that is they are antimicrobial in nature. The antimicrobial property is because they are cationic. So they bind the negatively charged molecules of the cell wall, that is lipopolysaccharide for example. After binding with the negatively charged molecules, they depolarize the membrane. That is, this binding will lead to depolarization of membrane, leading to increase in the permeability and hence ultimately cell death. That is, they can be called as bactericidal in nature, that is they cause cell death. Clear? This is how they protect, that is their protective phenomena. So ultimately, the role of antimicrobial peptide is protective phenomena by being present in the various tissues, for example, circular epithelium, junctional epithelium, and even in neutrophils. Clear? So this completes the role of antimicrobial peptides very briefly. And the last topic of this topic, that is therapeutic strategies. We will discuss therapeutic strategies with the summary of the topic. This will help us summarize the topic and discuss the strategies simultaneously. So we will begin with the microbial interactions, that is microbial aspects of host microbial interaction. Remember, bacterial survival and colonization, there were three steps: bacterial adherence, bacterial invasion, and evasion of the host defense mechanism. So here the therapeutic strategy can be the release of enzymes. Remember, in the microbial mechanisms, the enzymes release, that is collagenase or MMPs. So the first therapeutic strategy is targeting those enzymes, that is example MMP inhibitors or anticollagenase. Okay, the example is the low dose of doxycycline, example periostat. Please watch my video on periostat to understand it more better. It has given proven clinical outcomes in patients when administered as an adjunct to scaling and root planing, that is routine periodontal therapy. So the first therapeutic strategy is MMP inhibitors or collagenase inhibitors. Clear? Next, if we remember, the MAMP-PRR interaction will lead to the production of cytokines. So anti-cytokine therapy, that is TNF-alpha antagonists, which are soluble antagonists. So soluble antagonist of TNF or interleukins. So anti-cytokine therapy. Please note, they are not commercially available or validated or permitted. So don't start prescribing them from tomorrow onwards. They are just proposed mechanisms and strategies. Clear? They are not yet proven. Further researches have to be conducted so as to assess the result outcomes, the host response actually. The strategies are just proposed based on the mechanisms that have been delineated or studied upon. Clear? So these are just the proposed strategies and not the validated one or commercially available or permitted for prescription one. So therapeutic strategy number 3. Moving ahead, we have these pathways. So inhibitors of, let's say, nuclear factor kappa beta or MAPK will also help in getting treatment outcomes improvement. So this is another strategy, that is inhibitors of one of these molecules. For example, nuclear factor kappa beta and MAPK. Clear? The next we discussed was complement system. So the complement system, the main molecules were C3 and C5, which got cleaved and led to their respective key effector molecules C3A, C3B, C5A and C5B. So the inhibitors of those receptors of C3A and C5A, mainly C3, because that is the point where all the three pathways of complement converged and met along to carry forward the pathway further. So inhibitors of those complement factors and receptors can also be one of the therapeutic strategy available as an option. The results are yet to be explored again. And the last we discussed are antimicrobial peptides. So the best therapeutic strategy option based on antimicrobial peptide is the pure form of antimicrobial peptides. But it is a very expensive procedure. So we should look for the alternatives. The alternatives are the novel analogs, that is the molecules that mimics like antimicrobial peptides. The novel analogs of defensins, which is proven, defensins are proven in the research trials, of course in animals, yet to be explored further, but the novel analogs of defensins particularly are also associated with promising results. So these are the possible therapeutic strategies based on the knowledge of molecular aspects of host microbial interaction. A quick summary of the therapeutic strategies, beginning with the inhibitor of the enzymes, that is MMP inhibitors, collagenase inhibitors. Next, we have inhibitors of cytokines, that is anti-cytokine therapy, soluble antagonist of tumor necrosis factor and interleukins. Next, we have inhibitors of the pathway molecules, that is nuclear factor kappa beta or MAPK, followed by inhibitors of the complement factors and their receptors, mainly C3 and C5. And the last, analogs of antimicrobial peptides, mainly defensins. So this completes the entire topic, molecular aspects of host microbial interaction, part 1 and part 2. Please watch my video part 1 of the molecular aspects so as to better understand the part 2, that is the current video. I hope the entire topic is now clear to you all, but if you still have any doubts or any queries, feel free to ask me in the comment section below or mail them at tenderstudiesimplified@gmail.com. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well. Have a good day. Stay safe.